welcome to gracechurch.com online. It's July. I hope you are having a wonderful summer. Hope you've taken some time to rest and recuperate over this month. My name is Nairi and I'm really happy to welcome you to our online service today. This is the last of our series in July where we're hearing from different people in Grace Church as they share from God's word with us. And as ever, we have our wonderful worship team who have prepared a time of worship for us to join with today. Just a reminder that next week, the 2nd of August, is our first week meeting together in the Generator Hotel. You should hopefully have had information now as to which time slot you will be attending. But if you haven't heard or you're just wondering what's the details, then feel free to drop me an email at hey@gracechurch.se or you can contact us through our Facebook page. We're really looking forward to being able to meet together. And there will be an online option, as we've said, for people who are still staying at home or are unable to attend. If you're new to Grace Church and you've found us online and been watching online over the last few months, please do get in touch. If you're based in Stockholm, you are so welcome to join us as we meet in person. And we'd love to also connect you up with a small group. So get in touch with me via the email address or via Facebook and we can connect with you. Wishing you a wonderful Sunday and look forward to seeing you all soon.
Open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? Our God is greater. our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Team here at Grace Church. Today we're gonna think about, imagine this, You're 17 years old and life is good. Your father's favourite, he's a wealthy man, you've got all that you need. You're good looking and you know it. When you look in the mirror you think, God's gift. And then your father gets you a special expensive coat. And in the words of the musical that they write about you, you say to yourself, not so quietly that others can't hear you, I look handsome, I look smart, I am a walking work of art, such a dazzling coat of many colours, how I love my coat of many colours. Of course, I'm talking about Joseph. I love the story of Joseph. It's full of drama and action. I mean, really, it's got everything. It's a story that occupies more than a quarter of one of the longest books in the Bible, Genesis. And it has all the classic elements that you need for a real page-turner of a story. It's family rivalry, jealousy, hatred, wicked schemes, greed, sorrow, handsome men, beautiful women, kings, false accusation, prison, dreams, execution. It's a riches to rags to riches again. And finally, it's a powerful and moving reconciliation between a father and a son. It's gripping stuff. Joseph's story has been turned into musicals and films. And there are so many characters and events to look at. Do we follow the story from the view of the brothers who are provoked by their father's favoritism and their younger brother's arrogance into treachery? Do we follow the story of the powerful patriarch who dotes on his first son by his favourite wife, but who's tricked into thinking his son is dead and is left a broken and grieving old man? Do we watch Potiphar and his seductive wife, or the cupbearer, or Pharaoh? Or do we stick with the main lead, Joseph, the young star at the centre of all the drama? Let's travel back 3,800 years to ancient Egypt. It's a rich, powerful country, but it's one that was not quite as powerful as it used to be. Travel past the pyramids, down the Nile, to the city of Memphis, capital of Egypt. Travel past the houses and the homes of 500,000 people, past the house of Potiphar, captain of the king's guard, past the palace of the Pharaoh, and down to the prison. Prisons are never pleasant places. But in ancient Egypt, 4,000 years ago, rats, smell, death, disease could be a brutal place. And picture a young man of about 30 sitting on a bed of straw in his hot, sticky, sweaty cell, probably not his own, shared with many others. You could see that he would be a handsome man, but his hair is long and his beard is long and tangly and he badly needs a bath. The man's not Egyptian, but he's been in Egypt for more than 13 years, and a fair part of has been spent in this prison cell. His home is more than 300 miles away in another country to the far north, at the far north end of the Egyptian Empire. And he remembers 13 years ago, he was wearing a beautiful coat of many colours. He remembers how much his father loved him. He remembers going to visit his brothers as they were looking after the vast flocks of his father's sheep. And how he was lucky to escape death and instead had the good fortune to be sold into slavery by his brothers. He remembers the long journey from Canaan into Egypt. He remembers being picked by the Egyptian Potiphar and working in his household. He remembers fondly his master and how over the years he became in charge of the whole estate of this important man, organising all the other servants in his master's business, and how his master's household prospered in his care. He remembers thinking, perhaps God is with me still. His favour is with me even here in this foreign land. May his face darkens and you can hear the sigh. Sigh of despair as he remembers the night his master's wife accused him of trying to rape her, sleep with her, even when it had been the other way around, and how his master had burned with anger against him, and despite his years of faithful service, had, you know, didn't believe him, and thrown him into the highest security prison with the king's prisoners. He looks around his cell, and he manages even then a smile, because it seems that even there in the prison, his God hadn't left him. He'd found favour with the prison warden, and he had more freedom than most of the other prisoners, and he had good work for a prison. And he leans back against the wall, and he remembers when on his rounds he came across the recently imprisoned cupbearer and baker of the king, Pharaoh. And the morning after they'd had their dreams, he remembers that, you know, the cupbearer's there in prison and the baker's there in prison, and they both have dreams. And they're bewildered and they're confused and they're depressed and they don't understand what it was, their dreams. And when you have dreams those days, you know they mean something, but what do they mean? And these weren't just any dreams. These were dreams that, you know, they had significance. So he remembers opening his mouth and hearing the words come out of his mouth saying, "Don't interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dreams." What boldness, what a gift of spirit. "These things belong to God. You tell me and God will, you tell me your dreams and God will tell me the interpretation." Wow. He'd given the interpretations, and within three days, both men had been released, just as he said they would. It's 2 years ago now, and he'd heard from the warden, who'd heard from the bursar, who'd seen from the pharaoh, that one of them had been released, and the other hanged, just as he said would happen. But the cupbearer had forgotten Joseph, just like he said he wouldn't. And while those dreams had come true, he couldn't help thinking that perhaps his own dreams, Joseph's dreams, would never come true. His dreams 13 years ago that suggested his brothers and even his father and mother would bow down to him. After all, his father doesn't even know he's alive. This old man's probably dead and is hundreds of miles away and thinks his son is dead. I wonder what story he wonders. What did my brothers tell my father? And anyway, I'm in this prison. I may never get out. What happened to the baker may happen to me. Knowing all this tragedy, misfortune, you wouldn't blame him for feeling lonely or for feeling bitter against his brothers for their treachery and betrayal, for cursing them and in his head plotting revenge if he ever saw them again, knowing I probably never will. You wouldn't blame him for being resentful against his father for spoiling him or for wanting those days back again. You wouldn't blame him for refusing to forgive himself for his arrogance and pride that ruined his relationship with his brothers. Or you certainly wouldn't blame him for feeling sorry for himself. After all, what else could go wrong? He'd been betrayed, sold into slavery, robbed of position, falsely accused. He's in jail in a foreign land with no appeal and no hope of release. Death could be a welcome release to his misery. And most of all, you wouldn't blame him for giving up on God. After all, where are God's purposes in all of this? Like, how could this be God's will for my life? Yes, he'd known favour, but that's gone. His father favours him, and his brother takes it away. Potiphar favours him, and Potiphar's wife takes it away. The prison warden favours him, and the cupbearer forgets him. There's a pattern here. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So where's God now? Why does God want him in an Egyptian prison? If he thought to himself, So much for justice, so much for dreams, so much for the faithfulness of God, you wouldn't hold it against him. Why did God allow this to happen? We look at a man stuck and in no way able to control his circumstances. He's helpless to do anything to change his fate. What do we do in such circumstances? What if we felt God hadn't listened to us or had abandoned us? What would we do and think? What if 13 years had passed and the dreams that God had given us still hadn't come true? Would you forget them? Give up on them? Would you say it couldn't have been God? Or it happened by now? Must have just been making it all up. Perhaps you've asked questions like that. Like, what am I doing here? What could God's purpose possibly be for me in all of this? Perhaps you're asking questions in the midst of pain or broken dreams, or simply just nothing. Those times when God seems to be silent. Would we be faithful? Would we have any faith left at all? Would we truly believe the words of Romans 8:28, where it says, in all things, God works for the good of those who love him? Perhaps you've asked questions about the church. When will revival come? When will the word spoken over us come to pass? What will we believe? To whom will we be pointing to when the chips are down? The Joseph story has several more dramatic twists. The king has a dream that no one can fathom. And suddenly, in this dream, the cupbearer remembers Joseph. And before Joseph knows what happens, he's been shaved, cleaned, clothed, and he's standing before Pharaoh. He's asked, can he interpret dreams? The question he's asked is, will Joseph claim the credit and seek to obtain his freedom? He could just say, yes, I could do it. No, despite all that's happened, he insists that God's will be true. He says, no, I can't, but my God can. After 13 years of living in a land of foreign gods, of fighting the temptation to forget, Joseph has faith in his God, and God exalts him. In the space of a single conversation, Joseph has gone from prisoner to prime minister, in perhaps the most dramatic reversal of fortunes of all time. God gives an early demonstration of the words we find in Ephesians 3, that he's able to do more than we could possibly ask or imagine. What would Joseph have asked for? Perhaps freedom? The right to go home? What would he have dreamt of? His request being granted and maybe seeing his father one more time before his father died? What did he get instead? Riches, power beyond measure. Yet still, his own dreams had not come to pass, and he was still no closer to knowing the purposes of God. But what is God doing? God is putting the right person into the right place at the right time to accomplish his purposes and fulfill his promises. 7 more years pass. And as Pharaoh's dream comes into being, 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. God begins to play and reveal the cards in his hand. Like a master chess player, his moves had remained a mystery until the brilliance of the plan is revealed and the purpose made clear. God had promised Joseph's great-grandfather, Abraham, to make his family into a great nation. But now, with the onset of a severe famine, all of that is at risk. The lives of Jacob and his sons and all that had been built is threatened by starvation, and the only place where they have chance of survival is Egypt. Egypt that lives from the Nile and has been able to build vast storehouses that will see a powerful nation survive the worst of disasters. So now, more than 20 years after he had been sold for about 200 grams of silver by his brothers, there they are, kneeling before him, asking for food. Now the reason 20 years of exile becomes clear. God reveals himself to be faithful. Now God has brought the dreams to pass. And so Joseph sets up an emotional reunion with his father. We see in Joseph much that we see in Jesus. Betrayed by his brothers, he is exalted by and reunited with his father. Jesus foregoes vengeance or revenge and chooses to repay good for evil. He remains devoted to his father and he chooses to forgive instead of hate. And just as Joseph is a shadow of Jesus who is to come follow him 1700 years later, the theme of resurrection makes an early appearance as the son who was dead is brought back to life and exalted at the right hand of his father. Perhaps you're wondering what lies. Joseph goes beyond that. He receives a double honour. All his other brothers get to pass on inheritance to one of their sons. Joseph gets to pass on inheritance and receive a blessing for both of his sons. They're adopted by his father, receiving his blessing in Joseph's place. Joseph is now living in the revealed purposes of God. So maybe you're wondering what lies in store for you. Have you asked God, what am I doing here? What's going on? Why did this have to happen? Has God seemed to remain silent? Are you simply just hanging on in there? God says, have faith. Trust me. Vaughan Roberts writes, God always overrules to ensure that his gospel promises are protected. Even when we don't understand God's purposes, we can be sure that they're loving ones and they always guarantee that his will be done. Be assured that if promises remain unfulfilled, if words remain just that, words, this story reminds us that God does bless, God does redeem, God does restore, God does protect, and most definitely God does keep his word. God's plans are bigger than us, so often our dreams are about things going well for me, but God's not necessarily thinking about that. He's thinking about his purposes, and we get caught up in his purposes, which are much, much bigger. This wasn't actually about Joseph, it was about a nation. It was about God's promise that through this nation light would come to all nations. That this story about Joseph was ultimately actually about Jesus. And actually that points to God's purposes throughout all of creation. We get caught up in something bigger. It's not about you. But in the midst of it, when we're wondering about us, let's trust God. Hebrews says, faith is to believe what we do not see, and the reward of faith is to see what we believe. No, I don't think that was Hebrews. But it's a good line. Faith is to believe what we do not see, and the reward of faith is to see what we believe. Joseph believed that God would keep his word and his promises, even though he couldn't see how this would be possible. And his reward was to see it happen, to see God fulfill his word. He hung in there and he didn't give up. So for those of us who are simply hanging in there, I believe God is saying to you with the words of Jesus, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest, and you will find rest for your souls. Find the faith you need in Jesus Christ. Be encouraged, and God will reveal his plan. Amen.
Every time I face the waves, I don't want to be afraid. I don't want to be afraid. I don't fear the storm just because I hear it roar. I don't want to fear the storm. I don't want to fear the storm. Peace be still, say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea. till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. I'm not gonna be afraid, the waves are only waves. Oh, I'm not gonna be afraid, I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna fear the storm, it's being greater than its roar. I'm not gonna fear the storm, I'm not gonna fear it all, yeah. Peace, peace, still. Say the word and I will set my feet upon the sea, till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace, be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. Let faith rise up, oh heart, believe. Let faith arise in me. Let faith rise up, oh heart, believe. Let faith arise up in me. Peace, be still, say the word. And I will set my feet upon the sea, till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace, be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. Peace, peace over me. Peace, peace over me.